gentlemen. My name is Mike Dyer. I'm the curator of maritime history at the New Bedford Whaling Museum. And it's another one of these banner nights. You know, it's always a banner time when we get to introduce a new whaling history book. So we have a new whaling history book by Skip Finley, Whaling Captains of Color, America's First Meritocracy. Skip Finley undertook this entirely of his own volition to discover this history. And in his retirement, you know, he just sort of undertook becoming a writer and a historian, and he landed on this fascinating subject of whaling captains of color in the American whale fishery. This is a big and important story, as you know, whaling history itself, American whaling history itself, is big and important, and this book is a major new contribution, especially the biographies within it. Of these whaling masters and their the voyages that they commanded, where they went, the names of the vessels, the dates of the voyages, the time structure, you know, puts this entire story in a context starting as early as the 18th century and going right through to the end of Yankee whaling. So this book and the subject runs throughout the history of Yankee whaling. Let's give a warm welcome to Skip Finley. Skip, welcome.
Thank you.
Congratulations, and can't wait to hear what you have to say. Oh, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, you may ask questions. You can enter them into the chat at the bottom of your screen, and we will get to those at the end of the presentation, which should last about an hour. So you can go ahead and post your questions as we go along, and we'll get to your questions. At the end of Skip's presentation. So, Skip Finley.
Hi, thank you very much. I can't believe I'm sitting here with the Michael Dyer. The more I've learned about whaling, the more you learned about the really smart, capable, talented people who built a life around, you know, saving the history of this industry. And here, my story is pretty unique. I grew up during the summers here on Martha's Vineyard Island, which participated in the whaling business. The only evidence of it is when you walk around and see the multi-million dollar homes lining Edgartown Harbor here on Martha's Vineyard. And you see similar ones on Nantucket over in New Bedford, you know, to a large extent down in Sag Harbor and in the Hamptons. Well, the story starts when, you know, and in retiring from a radio broadcaster, which is something I was good at for, oh, the first 40 or so years of my career, one day decided to become a writer. And through a series of very fortunate circumstances, wound up writing the weekly Oak Bluffs Town column for our local paper here, the Vineyard Gazette, here where I've grown up on the island since 1955. This is a distinct honor because I was only the fifth person to ever write that column since the 60s. One of whom was a lady named Dorothy West, who was famous in her own right as one of those Harlem Renaissance writers. Anyway, in writing the column, a peculiar thing happened. The folks at Mystic decided to restore and refloat the whale ship, the Charles W. Morgan. And one of its stops was gonna be here on Martha's Vineyard, the significance of which totally escaped me. I knew absolutely nothing about it. But I did have a very close friend, Matthew Stackpole, who was very involved, you know, in relaunching that ship and raising the money for it, studying its history. And his father, who I'm a new huge fan of, has written several books, you know, about whaling. And I'll sidebar get to that, you know, in a second. Anyway, the Vineyard Gazette owns seven publications. I'm their director of sales and marketing, which is, you know, kind of an aside the point. I was wondering if I helped them generate revenue for the newspaper, it would, you know, they'd probably allow me to write, which is, you know, there's a balance in there somewhat. I think right now my revenue generating is better than the writing, but at least I was able to do some. Anyway, one of the products we own is called Martha's Vineyard Magazine. And its editor, Paul Schneider, decided to devote the entire May 2014 issue of the magazine to the Charles W. Morgan. Well, you know, before you ask why, it's because about seven of its captains and hundreds of people who worked on the Morgan over its many years of service were from here on the island. So that was a big deal. So Paul asked me, would I write a story about the black whaling captain? So, you know, all I heard was write and magazine, and I was in. You know, that was pretty easy. But it didn't take me long to realize I had never heard of a black whaling captain before and didn't know that much about whaling. So I proceeded to start doing some research on it. And almost immediately, within hours, it took me to find out, not only was this black guy a captain of a whale ship, but this occurred in the 1880s, which is, you know, 20 years after the Civil War. Well, a little bit more work later, and, you know, maybe I'm in week two or week three at this time, to my delight, found that not only was he not the only black whaling captain, but he was nowhere near the first. He was about the 30th. You know, the first of them, you know, of course, was Paul Cuffey. But anyway, so that's what precipitated this book. I'll have to admit, you know, I was a radio broadcaster. We all suffer from first being C students, which is A, and B, we're probably all ADHD, I know I am. And then there's the OCD, which allows you to do a lot of work in short periods of time and do a lot of research. And that's how this book started. But one thing, you know, led to another. I wound up investing several thousand dollars in buying these whaling books because I, you know, literally lost my mind. That's all I wanted to do. So I go to work and come home 5:30, 6 o'clock in the afternoon until, midnight, 1 o'clock, I was reading, researching, taking notes. And before I knew it, there was so much information, a book was just coming out of it. Anyway, I did finish the article about William A. Martin, who we thought was the Martha's Vineyard captain. By the way, since then, now we recognize there were five, including, you know, a man named John T. Gonzalez, who, as luck would have it, was the last of the captains of the Charles W. Morgan when it was actually in its whaling days. So tonight, what I wanted to share with you, you know, as I learned how to write a book, how to publish a book, which I hadn't done before, is doing the research, you know, doing the work. If you don't like it, you really shouldn't do it. I was totally invested. I was totally involved. I mean, to the exclusion of friends and food and TV and, you know, and hobbies, this is all I wanted to do, was to learn more about this and to put it on paper so, you know, it could be in one place where someone, you know, have the vantage point, being able to read it and see it. And it took a long time. Let me see. I think it's not exactly, but I've read about 140. I've read and own about 140 books on whaling, which is almost all of them. Some of them, by the way, are in Portuguese, so I can't even read them. I can only look at the pictures. I've also read probably 100 plus what they call monographs, which is similar to a Harvard case study about whaling. I mean, pretty much everything on the internet. Much of what you find on the internet, you know, is not true, wrong, and accurate. So you have to parse your way through it. And finally, after, I remember literally the email that I sent to my publisher, you know, here's the book, here's the manuscript. You know, by the way, how long do you think it should be? I'd never thought to ask that question. And she responded with, 70 or 80,000 words. And it's like, oh my goodness, I just sent you 160,000. She said, hell no, that's not gonna work. You know, you're writing a book about what we believe is 50 some men. You're not writing the Bible. We're gonna have to cut back on this somewhat. So with the help of an editor, I was able to winnow my way through, about 90,000 of those words, which is, if it didn't have anything to do with whaling, if it didn't have to do with black whaling masters, then take it out of the book, you know, which I, you know, did with some religion. That was the first. And then when my publisher got it, the second thing she said was, okay, you know, she probably looked at it for about an hour and she sent me an email. She says, okay, Wiki is not an acceptable source, neither is ancestry.com. you know, these are not things that you can use. So I'm like, okay. And that probably removed another 30,000 or 40,000 words, you know, right then. Because, you know, when you're writing a scholarly work of nonfiction, those are not legitimate sources. As she said to me, it's pretty much, you know, garbage in, garbage out. Everyone gets to contribute to Wiki, although it's useful, it's interesting, and not that it's wrong, but you need to do some work. You need to find more legitimate sources to back up what you have to say. Regarding that, just for 1 minute, because it's kind of a technical note. My responsibilities in the radio business was, you know, quite often buying and selling radio stations. A lot of my time was spent with financial matters, you know, writing business plans, you know, overseeing financial tranches, as it's called, raising money, borrowing money, you know, from banks. And along the way, you have to perform what's called due diligence, meaning anything you say, you damn well better be able to prove. And that was extraordinarily helpful to me discipline-wise in obtaining this information, then proceeding to write about it, you know, itself. One thing, quite fortuitously, I knew about note-taking. So every time I wrote something that was a fact, I had a footnote, you know, with it. Now, of course, no one wants to read a book with, I think the first number she said was like I had 1,400 footnotes in the book. She says, no. She says, you know, you have to make sure when someone picks your book up that they don't put it down. And every time you put a footnote in, that's a reason for them to go to the back of the book and stop reading and put your book down again. So, you know, I learned, you know, very quickly. You know, now the next question that most people ask is, you know, how did you find these people? Well, everyone gets a gift. Mine was I read very fast. And from a very young age, I was reading when I was young, and I read very fast. And I absorb a lot of information, and I've been trained in how to do that, you know, in the radio station, you know, business, if you will. So it was easy to write that. What was useful was every time I saw something that I didn't know and was interested to me, I take one of the little stickers and stick it into the book. So, you know, now those books over there, as you see behind me, have been completely defaced. I've written in all of them. I got stickers all over the place. But I wrote all that information down under some specific subject on what's called a spreadsheet, many of you, you know, are familiar with. A spreadsheet, when you do financial modeling, is as I did for a number of years, because, you know, kind of second nature with me. And as it turns out, it's a great way to do research, because as you are then writing, you think, well, how fast was a whale? I could look up whale speed, word whale, and then speed, you know, next to it. That dovetails, you know, quite nicely into, you know, by time I had exhausted the interweb and all the books that I bought and found myself traveling over to the New Bedford Whaling Museum. And if you have not been to the New Bedford Whaling Museum, it's spectacular. It's, you know, I've described it as a jewel box for whales. You know, if it's about whales, it's there. They have a room there. The Scrimshaw room, I call it. It's probably 80 or so feet, or take your house and put your house behind your house, gut it so it's one big room and fill it with priceless objects of art. I don't even think the museum itself knows, but, you know, I wouldn't be stunned to find there was $1 billion worth of art of carved sperm whale teeth that people have made into art. So it's that type of a place. Now, when I first started going, the library museum was up the street. They just, you know, raised a ton of money and rebuilt the museum itself, and they added the library to it. So I was going over there, and, you know, every once in a while there'd be another human there besides a young man named Mark Prochnik, who finally, after my second, third, maybe even the fourth visit, says, you know, I see you all the time. What the hell are you doing? So I said, well, I'm doing research about black whaling captains. And he says, oh, great. You know, let me help you. I've got all kinds of information. You know, there's at least a dozen of these guys. I said, well, so far I'm up to 40, but I'd love to see the dozen that you have. And from there, I got the edge. By the way, when I was in high school, I worked in a library, so I was familiar with it. You know, so I knew about things like card catalogs, Well, they don't have a card catalog for black whaling captains. They have a card catalog that they call, you know, a library. And if you don't know where things are, they're very difficult to find. And Mark knew exactly where everything was. Some things in particular, you know, for example, he says, who do you have? So I showed him my list. You know, here's the names of the guys, that I'm pretty sure captains. And here's what little I know about them. I said, okay, they did have the semblance of a card catalog with the names of all these guys. So since I had the name, I could then go to that little box and look their names up, find out more about them. Then he shared with me, there's a technical name for it. I don't know what it is, but I call it, you know, the Veteran Whaling Museum scrapbook collection, which is when a whaling captain dies, you know, whaling wasn't as important to people back then as they are now. You know, your average barber, you know, probably engendered more respect than a whaling captain did for all of the wrong reasons. You know, begin with how heroic they were, you know, to go out and spend 2.5-3 years aboard a whale ship, you know, travel 10,000 miles away from home, not knowing if they're going to get back again or what they're going to eat or drink along the way. But anyway, we did that, but these scrapbooks were important to the families, and the families kept as much information as they could, and they put them in the scrapbooks. And when they or the captains had died, they donated to the museum. And if any of you have information like that, please, please take it over there and at least let the folk, Michael, you know, Mark, and the folks in the museum take a look at what you have. I say that, and again, I'm, you know, little sidebar. There have been about 15,200 and some whale trips by 2,700 ships over almost a 280-year period. And each of those ships has what's called a log. There are only about 3,000 of those logs left that we're aware of. So most of what we know from people painstakingly reading some very badly written old, you know, things on paper that was not expected to last 200 or 300 years, although much of it has. Anyway, let me not get too far off that story. So the next thing after finding these scrapbooks and looking these men's names up, and at times I read fast, I won't lie, I did spend hours sitting in front of these scrapbooks, just reading them like they were literature, you know, finding things out, taking notes about them and putting them on my various spreadsheets, which is the next part of it. While I was doing this, you know, Mark says, hey, look, we have this thing called the crew list, which I was completely unfamiliar with. The basis of which was when people were whaling, a customs officer, a captain or someone would record the names and pertinent information about the 20 or 30 some guys getting on this ship who may never be seen again, you know, which didn't happen as much as, you know, you would think. You know, hold Moby Dick in the back of your mind for a second, or at least the 9 of us who may have read the full thing. I'll say 10 of us, because, you know, I know Michael's probably memorized the thing. But that crew list, over the years, I think the first thing was during the Depression, the Workers' Progress Administration was looking for ways to put people back to work. And they would employ artists, people with, you know, not a whole lot of practical skills to do what, you know, may be termed menial labor. And they were able to take all this information and record it onto index cards, which over the years, then thanks to the Bedford Whaling Museum and Mystic, you know, the Library of the Street and the Bedford Free Public Library, they made spreadsheets of all this information listing the name of the person, what they looked like, and all this pertinent information. Now that information for a second, it would be illegal today, but when you got on a whale ship, it would be recorded, you know, not just your name and where you were from, where you were born, where you left from, but, you know, how tall were you? What was your eye color? What was your skin color? And that was, for a task like mine, that skin color thing was absolutely huge, because I'm a master of spreadsheets. I could go through this spreadsheet. I think it was 125,000 lines long and about 18 columns wide. So if you have that picture in your mind of all this information, you can do what's called data sorted by any of the variables of those, you know, 12, 18, you know, columns worth of information, you know, sideways or, you know, or across. which of course I did. And all of a sudden, you know, the names start and their titles, their ranks started just dropping out of the page. So then I had another starting point of going back to the scrapbooks, going back into the card catalog files to find more about these people. By the way, I also kept notes from all the books that I was able to acquire, so that I had the benefit of the bibliographies they had. So, you know, now when I pick up a whaling book, I'm sorry to say I don't start the first page. I start at the back and I want to see first the bibliography. Is there a book I'm not familiar with that I need to get, and then go get it? And once I have that book, then I go down to index. Are any of the people that I'm familiar with already listed in these books, or are there ships? So that was how I was over a great deal of a large period of time, you know, putting all this stuff together. Once I learned what the crew list was, Mark said, you know, I said, can I use this? Because they had a little standalone PC, you know, in the library. He said, no, I'll email it to you. You can do it from home. I go, oh God, you know, someone just gave me a spreadsheet to play with. It was, you know, one of them. I don't live a dull life, but that was a very exciting moment in my life. I got to tell you that. And I absolutely had a ball with it. But then it occurred to me, why don't I go over to the New Bedford Public Library where they still had the index cards? Okay, so, you know, because some of the information in those cards might not have been translated to the spreadsheets themselves. So I did. And I can tell you there are 133 drawers with these index cards, which have, you know, 100,000 or so, you know, names. But I was able to find even more information. So, by the way, technically, when you're doing, you know, real research, when you're doing scholarly research, when you're allowed to go into the, you know, to the New Bedford Public Library, and when you're allowed to go into the library of the Whaling Museum at Nantucket, certainly New Bedford, here on Marsman, you know, anywhere, only thing you can go in there with is yourself. You can't bring a pen or a pen, you know, or pencils. They give you pencils and pieces of paper, because they're trying to retain these artifacts, you know, that are hundreds of years old in most cases when you're talking about whaling. So I bought myself one of the little portable scanners instead of having Mark jump up and down every, you know, 5 or 6 minutes and, you know, here's a nickel, make me a copy of this. So I started making my own. So I had digitized versions of all this stuff. So then when I got back to the house here in my office, I'd be able to, you know, have a complete picture of this and be able to go through the information and put it together in some fashion. You know, now, those are some of the mechanics. Well, the times when you put in the work, which is a four-letter word, another four-letter word comes out of it, which is luck. I found some information that it, and I actually, when I started this, my notion was just as my task was to tell me something, write an article about this black whaling captain. It didn't take me long to find out the word black was not useful when it came to whaling, you know, which is, that's why I adopted the term, you know, whaling captains of color. You know, nowadays we think of black people, you know, as African-American, you know, well, for over half the time whaling was a business, there was no such thing as an African-American, okay? They weren't Americans till 1865 at the very back end of slavery. So the term was useless. You know, how do you describe someone who may have been a slave, who may have been African, and however slavery or whatever got to the West Indies? Okay, so someone who lives in, you know, Jamaica, one of these countries in the Caribbean, what do you call these folks? You know, because, you know, African American's not going to work. Black didn't really cut it. And then you branch out and you learn that, you know, the Native American community, you know, you can give Native Americans, you know, pretty much all the credit, you know, for establishing whaling as a thing, maybe not as an industry or as a business. You know, I like to ascribe that, you know, to the Quakers, to the Friends. You know, that's my judgment. But, you know, how does that work? You know, well, there was quite a bit of intermarriage between, you know, black people and Native Americans. There was some between white people and Native Americans. And in fact, our first, you know, black captain, if you will, was half African and half Native American. He was a Wampan, you know, half Wampanoag, Paul Cuffee. And he wasn't the only one. So if you look at the 50, 51 folks, I'm pretty sure were people of color, and captains. I think there may have been about another dozen. I was unable to prove to my satisfaction, you know, were they specifically Black or a person of color, you know, or were they a captain at all, because, you know, just wasn't able to do that. And I know it's not a great deal of people. In fact, to put that in perspective, there have been twice as many Black quarterbacks who played in the NFL than there have been whaling captains. You know, so yes, I know it's a small but honorable group of very, very, very brave people that I was able to discover doing this. Once you have their names, then it was up to me to find out how did they get there? Because there are literally books that have lists like Judith Lund's book, you know, American Whaling Voyages, and it tells you the name of the captain. But how they get to be a captain, which is the next question that, you know, people ask a lot. And it was one I had to find out for myself. That answer was kind of easy, but let me go back and circle back around to the, you know, very gratuitously fortunate thing that happened to me. Once I realized that Native Americans were also couched as persons of color and had been captains, I found out about a couple of guys, the Lee brothers from Long Island, and found that a lady named Nancy Shoemaker, Professor Shoemaker, had written a book about Native American whalers. I didn't know much about the Lees, and, you know, it's hard to find information. I'm like, you know, she's written a couple of these monographs. So I contacted her and she said, well, what are you doing? So I explained to her. We got to talking, you know, and then she said, you know what? And I explained, you know, the crew list and how I was going about them. And she laughed and she says, well, she'd done a lot of that research too. So I said, okay, how did you, you know, do yours? She read 2,100 of the 3,000 or so remaining logs and jotted down all the information about these men of color who participated on these trips. For me, it was an absolute gold mine, because she had the names of these guys when they were harpooners, or they were boat steerers, or they were the mate on these ships that you don't see just that because you found out they were captains. So I was able to, you know, create some kind of fulsome background of what they did first. Now, the answer to that question, however, you know, is, you know, how do you get to be a whaling captain? I think is preceded by, why did you decide to get onto a whaling ship? Okay. I'm going to use my information. I say probably 175,000 people from roughly the late 1600s, early 1700s, when records started being kept, until 1928, depending on how you view the last whaling trip. Was it New Bedford? Was it San Francisco? But in that period of time, all of those people who went on a whale ship, probably 90% only went once and said, I don't ever want to do this again. So yes, when Charles W. Morgan was here in Martha's Vineyard, I was invited to go aboard. I was very excited until I realized there was nowhere except the top deck where I could stand up. I don't ever want to be on a whale ship again as long as I live, now that I know more about it. Because the reason that so many people went on it, because of its romantic notions, this is going to be fun, I'm going to make my fortune, I'm going to come back, buy the big house along the water, get married, have a bunch of kids, and things are going to be fine. That's not how it works out, and it doesn't work out that way for everyone, although it did for enough so that this industry was, I think, the third largest in the state of Massachusetts and the fifth largest in America for a great, great deal of number of years, you know, in America. So the first part is, why didn't people stay on that ship for so long? You know, well, you know, let me go back to, you're on that, the average, you know, 2.5 to 4 years on a ship that's maybe 100 feet long. So go back to, we use your house as a reference. Now go back and take your house and multiply times three and put them in a row together and gut the inside. Now you're aboard a whale ship, except that you're on land. You're not out bobbing around, you know, in miles and miles and miles of the depths of the oceans, you know, from the trench in Puerto Rico that I think is 7 miles, you know, to the one we fish out of, you know, here between, you know, Martha's Vineyard and New Jersey. 100 feet sounds large until you put your feet on a real whale ship, you know, like the Charles W. Morgan, which wasn't the biggest by any stretch of the imagination, but it was a very fulsome ship. You know, when you saw, when I saw it, that beautiful sunshiny day when the sky was that, Chambers Company blue, and it comes over the horizon with those sails, you know, completely furled. It's one of the prettiest things you're ever going to see. When it gets closer to the dock, you get a full understanding how small it was. And you're going to be in this boat for the next 3.5 or 4 years, or however long it is. You know, you're not going to run out of water. It's going to go bad, you know, before you really get anywhere. You're not going to run out of food because the food wasn't that good to begin with. And it's even a judgment call nowadays, if you could call some of what people existed on was food, you know, in the first place. But anyway, you know, it was bad. It was hard. It was a difficult proposition. Probably you should mention it was dangerous. Not Captain Ahab dangerous. Yes, the whale ship Essex, you know, was attacked by a sperm whale. Its anniversary is coming up later this month, I think November 20th, 21st, something like that. Yes, there are enough of these, you know, when a whale attacked a whale ship, that was a big deal. That was a big story. And of course, it all follows from the only story we know, which is, you know, Captain Ahab, you know, and this whale. I'm not sure there's a lot of proof that whales have that type of, you know, the temperament for revenge, that we see in both the Essex, you know, and the, the Pequod. In any event, though, probably 45 captains were actually killed by whales. Once you jump off of a 100-foot ship into a 30-foot boat and you row a couple of miles out to attack a creature that's, you know, maybe 100 feet long and 50 tons, you expect that bad things can happen, but it wasn't as prevalent as you would think. You know, then of course there was mutiny. You know, yes, that happened a lot, but on a whale ship, a whaling captain was omnipotent. You know, in order to maintain discipline for, you know, 3-4, I think the longest whale trip was 11 years and 11 months. You're the man, you're in charge, and you need to exert that discipline however you can. Until 1850, captains were allowed to flog their men. Flogging, we don't hear or see too much about it. So it's kind of unimaginable, but this occurred, you know, on a regular basis on these whale ships. So there wasn't a whole lot of appealing reasons to go on these trips to begin with. And once you did, you wanted to get off that boat as quickly as you could. But a lot of folks didn't have that latitude. Persons of color, the expression that I use, they couldn't go back and go to work on Dad's farm, you know, or in the paint store or at his or her his newspaper. There were no her in those days. And I'm sorry, it was, you know, this is all guys. So they went on trip after trip after trip. So the first thing was, if you were talented enough to get on that boat and row over there and stab a whale and hold on to it long enough for it to die or get close enough so you can stab it and stab and stab until it died, and then tow it and row it back and cut up and make it into the products, you know, that we learn how to consume to light our homes and our streets and fuel the heat of our homes. That was a little bit different, but that was very challenging. That was very hard work. That was very dirty work. It was smelly. I have yet to find anything appealing about whaling, absent some probably wonderful sunsets and sunrises, you know, that you can only see when you're 1,200 miles on the Pacific Ocean. You know, by the wildlife, the sea life that you may see, you know, must have been, you know, magnificent. But overall, the majority of the time, you know, if you kind of sort of do the math, over that 280-year period, they probably were able to capture less than one whale a month. Now, I know that's not good if you're a whale, but, you know, if that's your business, you know, you're not very excited on a whale ship. Most of your time is spent in complete and utter boredom. There is no TV, there is no radio, there are no books, you know, there's really nothing. You know, a letter from home was something that if you're fortunate enough to receive it, you know, you might keep that until, you know, it just wound up tattering itself because you read it so many times. So these are the reasons that the folks who were left behind were these men of color who didn't have other options. And as luck would have it, after probably your third or fourth whale trip, you knew the drill. This was an industry without technological improvement for the most part. You know, some people can say, well, we had the bomb lances, you know, so we could shoot the harpoon into the whale. Most whalers, you know, would tell you that that didn't work that well. The best way to do it was to get close enough, you know, and stab it. So I'm a numbers nut. I did some research and found a guy named Claude Oliveira actually stuck a harpoon into a whale from about 40 feet away. And that's apparently the record for someone doing that, which is another way of saying every time someone stuck a whale with a harpoon, they were closer than 40 feet away. Now, again, you're in a 30-foot boat built for speed, built because it's light, not for its strength, not for its ability to keep the water out, you know, not necessarily you in the boat. That was the first part of technology they used to attack that whale. The second part was it took till, I think it was 1844, when Lewis Temple, another black guy, had been a former slave, and he was a blacksmith, but he made the one improvement in harpoons with a thing called Temple's toggle. So when the harpoon sticks in, he had a little part on the end of it to make sure that it stayed in the whale, because for a number of years, you know, if you didn't hit the whale in a bad spot, the harpoon was just going to come out. So you had everything going against you in whaling, except that huge prize. If you were one of the, not that many, but if you were one of the ships to come back with 2,000 barrels of oil, you know, you were done. You were the fundamental equivalent of today's millionaire. And today, I guess a millionaire, you need to have five to make that work. But, you know, that was the level field that you were playing on. Not everybody got that. So anyway, that was went into my finding the information about these people and then what to do with it and how to put that in one centralized place like a book to tell that story. I made a huge number of mistakes. You know, for example, the first thing I did, just because it's the data can be overwhelming. You know, you have to find a way to manage it. The easy way to do it is I kept my captains alphabetically on one hand, and then I decided I would write about them in the year that they became captain. All right. And as I did that first draft of the book and everything, it was totally boring. You know, it was totally boring because there was no theme. There was no context as to what's going on here. You know, and the story of whaling itself is big enough so there are 150, you know, fulsome books about it, and there's not a lot of repetition, you know, I might add. You know, of course, you know, there's some as you would expect. So once my editor suggested, you know, well, Skip, you know, why don't we approach this differently? You know, why don't you tell the story of these guys, but also tell the story of whaling, okay? And if it makes sense to put them in some chronological order like I had them, you know, then we do that. Well, that was a little bit different because, you know, then we could start with the folks who were in the early days of whaling and how they got there. You know, you can talk about, you know, what it was like, you know, for a Paul Cuffey. He was first a captain of his own ship in 1778. That's 2 years past the revolution. You know, these men weren't freed or, you know, and, you know, until 1865, 1868, depending on how you view Juneteenth. You know, what happened in all those years, you know, for these men to be able to produce this product, this enviable product. So that was, you know, how and why I did these and how it came with the story. And then I introduce other things. You know, then we could tell the story of, the first whalers, you know, the Native Americans and how they fit in. And we can then tell the story about the last whalers, the Cape Verdeans, and how they fit in as well. You know, Cape Verdeans, you know, a little bit differently. I grew up on the island here with, you know, a bunch of Cape Verdean friends, and I know, you know, a bunch of folks now over in New Bedford. I spent, you know, a lot of time there. You know, and the Cape Verdean community, you know, they may be from Africa, or as one of my friends that I mentioned in the book, you know, we're the people who came to America on purpose. You know, they didn't, but Cape Verdeans did not come here as slaves. They don't consider themselves to be slaves. They don't consider themselves to be black. And I mean that not in the context, you know, of color, but I mean in the context of race. You know, yes, white people will look at them and say, you're people of color, you know, you're black, and you know, and call it a day. But they didn't feel that to be true themselves. And if you think about it, they have a different language in Criollo. Their food is different. Their religion is somewhat different, although, you know, heavily Christian, you know, and Catholic. But their country is the probably the best description is their country is a polyglot. You know, you can't say really any one thing about them. But it was the Cape Verdeans who, because of their absence of natural resources, were able to get into whaling, all right, and take it to its ultimate conclusion. And at the end of whaling, they were the ones who bought the majority of the whale ships that were left, and they used them as for what they call packet ships. So they could take the ship over to, you know, to their country, you know, west coast of Africa, and they could bring products and people back, and then they could bring products and goods, you know, to the people who are over there still left behind. Michael, did you, okay. I thought you were gonna say something there.
We got about 15 minutes left.
Okay, all right. Once all that is, you know, has been, you know, put together, I think for me anyway, several things, you know, came out of this. Martin Luther King was right. Okay, you know, a man, if judged by their character, you know, imagine the character of a person whose business plan is to manage about 30 other humans, take them away for 3 or 4 years, participate in an industry that is dangerous, barbaric, uncomfortable, bereft of comfort in from any perspective that you know you care to realize, but could successfully get that boat out there, get those whales, turn it into oil, render it into oil and whale products, and bring it back here to America. Another surprising part was, and you know, people have asked me that, is, well, how come these Black guys don't have the, you know, the big white houses along the water? Despite the money a lot of them made, you must consider the times. And in the times, Black people weren't getting loans and getting mortgages from banks. You know, they didn't have the ability to, you know, hire people to build places for them. So they did as best they could. So the money that they made, and some made a substantial amount of money, was not translatable in terms of a legacy. Okay, you know, that money became the funds they needed to live off of, and their children, and if they were fortunate, that their children's children were able to live off, you know, as well. But there was no place for them to invest that money, you know, like the rest. You know, and, you know, I was in the money business for quite a number of years. Money's never lost. Money just changes pockets, you see. So when whaling ended, people were able to, and it ended because, you know, we could get shale oil in Pennsylvania in 1857. You know, whaling ended in 1928, but you don't have to take a chance in your life to dig that oil out of the ground. So people changed the business, if you will. Instead of using whales for the oil, now let's, you know, collect the baleen and make products out of it. Baleen, the quick notion is, baleen is a product hangs, you know, in the whale's mouth, which the whale uses to separate the krill that it eats from the water, you know, so, you know, it could eat that. It was found if you heat this material, it will retain whatever shape you left it in, and a function like what we know today as spring steel or plastic. So of course you can see once plastic and spring steel were invented, there was no need, you know, for baleen, you know, or whale bone. You know, once oil was easier to discover coming out of the ground or out of the water or wherever, you didn't have to take your life in the hands and go kill a whale. So ultimately the industry, you know, itself died. But the money built the textile industry in Massachusetts, southeastern Massachusetts. The money built the cranberry industry in southeastern Massachusetts. You know, that's what was left from it. You know, so, you know, the land that was amassed from these funds and, you know, the people found ways to make this money work. And ironically, I found recently, you know, having started as a money guy and now becoming, you know, changing that left brain for right brain, becoming a writer, You know, the whaling as a business enterprise is literally the forerunner of our private equity funds or our venture capital today. And there've been a couple of studies written about that as well, because the business model, you know, was so useful. You know, it wasn't quite like sharecropping, but a bunch of folks got together. And on each one of these 15,000 ships, by the way, was a separate business enterprise. And they invest into a whale ship and say they spend $40,000 to $60,000 to buy, outfit, repair, replace, construct a whale ship. Then we're going to hire management, the captain and his mate, harpooner, boat steerer. Then they're going to hire a crew. They're going to go out here, you know, and get these whales. But when they come back, there was an equitable distribution of the proceeds. Okay, the investors first take their expenses back, you know, to get covered, and then proportionally share in the value of the products that came back. And that's the latest thing I've been working on, is trying to figure out, you know, how many whales did they kill and how much money was there. And despite the wealth of information, it's going to be an impossible task, you know, to come up with a pure number for that. But context-wise, it was useful for me. I was able to, you know, making a lot of guesses. In fact, Michael helped me with, you know, with one of those. You know, I wasn't sure how big a barrel was, you know, a whale barrel. You know, I've been using 40 gallons, and Mike says it's like 32 to 35. So I've changed that. But if you take all the barrels that it's recorded that these black person, men of color brought back with them, they probably returned with close to $70 million in today's money, okay, over that long period of time. That's quite a bit of money. To my knowledge, there are almost no groups of persons of color who are able to generate that type of money ever. And well, until recently, you know, now you can say, you know, meritocracy is the NBA, and, you know, they got ball players and make that whole $70 million themselves in a couple of years. But in any event, you know, that was how much money. I like to use a number that, you know, it's probably north of $10 billion that the industry was worth from its start to its finish. Several people have taken stabs at that. You know, not very good ones, not very complete ones. You know, again, despite the wealth of information people have saved, I'm gonna come right back around to that information in a moment. But it was so long ago, it's so hard to determine. There's so many variables, you know, beginning with, you know, how big is a whale and what you define as a whale. Well, you know, these guys weren't too particular with what they were filling barrels with. You know, it might have been, you know, a small pilot whale, you know, not just a sperm whale, which is the top of the food chain, if you will, because, you know, its products burn quicker, you know, and without smoke. Anyway, we're probably ready for questions. Oh, no. How do we find this guy? The Seamen's Protection Papers, I mentioned that a little bit earlier. Today, it will be illegal. You know, when you get a job to write down, well, this guy is black, and, you know, this guy is Native American, or this person has, you know, this color hair, or, you know, these proclivities, I guess is the word we'd use nowadays. But since they collected that data, we are now able to find, you know, out all this information about them and about their business.
Well, there was a very good reason for those Seamen's Protection Papers. The identification of the individual was important in case they were impressed or were being discharged in a foreign port, or if there was some question as to their nationality and whether they actually belonged to that ship or not. Right. So there was the crew list, there was the shipping articles, and then there was the protection paper. And that protection paper was their passport. That was their, you know, was their document that said they were, they belonged on this American ship, and whether or not they were an American or not, it didn't matter. They belonged to the ship, and in some cases they were in fact American citizens, but, you know, the Seamen's Register, you know, that you perused so thoroughly, you know, lists not only the place of residence, but where these people were born. Right. And in addition to the physical description, those clues, especially where they were born, can really tell you an awful lot about the makeup of the crew. I also didn't mention
those papers. Whaling occurred during the Revolutionary War, the War of 1812, the Civil War. You know, so we were fighting the whole period of time, and whaling was that important to our economy that it was attacked along with us. I forgot to mention that.
Just as a point of interest, that's my next book.
Really?
I'm working on it right now.
Oh, that's brilliant. That is so brilliant. I can't wait.
Yankee Whaling in the U.S. Navy talks all about the interaction between those two sea services and the way whaling sort of demanded the protection of the Navy, and the Navy in turn tapped the whale fishery for all sorts of cartographic information,
right?
All kinds of reasons to be protecting American interests in Japan, for instance.
Yep.
Islands in the Pacific and elsewhere around the world. So it's this whaling subject just goes on and on.
Oh man, I can't wait. The dumb stuff they did, the Stone Fleet.
Yeah, right.
You gotta be kidding. Let's sink all the whale ships so the English can't get in, so the the rebels can't get in the harbor. Come on, man.
It didn't really work.
Oh, I can't wait. Where are you on this? When can I see it, man?
Oh, 2020, end of 2021, and then the exhibit. There'll be an exhibit opening in the springtime.
Oh,
2022. So
I can't wait.
It's a ways along, but you know.
Brilliant.
You know, you really have done yeoman's work here. You know, really documenting these people. I wonder. Let's see. So far, we have a couple of comments. Lynn took her elderly father to see the launch of the Morgan at Mystic Seaport, and she went on to say that your book and everything that it covers has been sort of an important part of their life. So that's what Lynn has to say. Tracy is curious about whether any Black women shipped as men, as the occasional white woman did in whaling history. Did you come across anything like that?
I did not. I did find a couple that went with their husbands, the whale ship captains on ships. In fact, a couple notable ones were, Valentine Rose's wife was on the ship with him when it was sunk, you know, and they both made it back alive.
Was that the Claudia?
Yeah, begins with a C too. I would have to go and look.
Well, we'll look in your index.
Look in the index, yeah. Okay. Another one, William Shorey took his wife with him, and he wound up having to leave her in Hawaii because she was pregnant to give birth to one of his children.
The whole relationship.
And there's a couple great books. Lisa Norling, wrote a fabulous book, Wooden Ships, Iron Women, something like that.
No, Captain Ahab had a wife.
Captain Ahab had a wife, right.
Captain Ahab had a wife, which is not to be confused with...
There's another one, right.
The work of fiction.
Correct.
So this is a work of real,
right,
major scholarship about women on shore, the communities on shore as the men were out doing whatever it was they were doing out there in the world. Let's see, Chris... Yeah, were there any petticoat whalers of color?
So. Yeah, none that I was able to discern.
Apart from the women that sailed with their husbands.
Another thing I found, quite by accident, but the majority of whaling, you have to remember, occurred during Victorian times. Okay, because I did a little bit of research. There wasn't as much homosexuality as you would think that I was able to discern on whale ships, for that long a period of time. Now, of course, a lot of that had to do with the physical conditions of a ship. When you spent a couple of years living in the backseat of your SUV was your allocation of space. But the times themselves, did not allow those type of relationships, this is way before people were thinking of the word suffragette, okay? So it was exclusively a male business.
Did you look into Howes Norris at all, the master of the Sharon?
And I mean,
he apparently used that black cook.
That and dude I was nuts. Wonder
whether that was a homosexual relationship, because it was pretty.
What was duly unusual is the man is, and he's from Martha's Vineyard. The man was cast as a racist, and you know, and it'd be hard, you know, for that not to be true. But he had other black guys on the boat who he did not treat like that.
Right.
All right. So he was just focused on this one guy. He literally kicked the man to death, you know, before the crew fought back and
right. got him out of there. And in case the people don't know, the Kanaka crew members on board the Sharon took whaling tools and hacked Howes Norris to pieces and threw the pieces overboard. So right. there was some vengeance for his
and then you know, which is a parallel of, you know, how bad was slavery. Those guys killed themselves because they thought they're going to be taken back to America and become slaves, so they jumped off the boat. I think one guy, you know, did the Harry Carey in the stomach, and another one jumped off the boat. That might be another story I'm thinking of.
Very rare.
Yeah.
That's a very rare sort of thing to have happened. One of the things in your book that I really, really liked was the story of the captain where you included the, I think his name is Samuel Williams, where you included the letter of instruction from the Nantucket agent to the master.
Yes.
I really like that because you don't really see letters of instruction very often brought up as the primary sources, you know, that they really are for guiding masters on these long voyages.
Yeah. George, I'm forgetting his name. What was more interesting, as interesting, was that guy's first captain was one of the Wainers over out of Dartmouth, you know, in New Bedford. He actually stole a whaling ship and turned it into a slave ship. He was one of the few to do that. Now, that wasn't Babson. Goodness.
Samuel Wilson or Samuel Williams. It's in here.
Yeah. I forgot. Now I'm going to go grab the book and look at it.
But Samuel W. Harris. Samuel Harris.
Oh, okay. All right. Now, as it turns out, That Samuel Harris, my friends at the Nantucket Historical Association say was not black, that he was white. The story is there were three Samuel Harrises on Nantucket at the time. All three were involved in whaling. I thought that this was the black one based on two other sources that I have. Martha Putney's book, Black Sailors, you know, and one from Harold, I forget his name too. But they both, you know, that's how I discovered, you know, this guy. Over in Nantucket, they have the Barney genealogical. Yeah, right. Okay, and they said, no, this guy's in here, you know, this is a white guy. The other two, one who was a whaler and he was on the Loper and some of these other ships, you know, some of these other guys, died when he was like 30 some years old, inexplicably. The other one was a man who, a friend of his on a whaling ship, had a baby with the man's wife. Okay.
Oh, dear.
Samuel Dwyer, I think, which is why Samuel Dwyer left Nantucket, no relationship, but he went to Nantucket and became to be a big deal in South Africa as a sealer. There's an island named after him, but they said that was incorrect. But there are two of those. That one very, very long letter is literally from the owners of the whale ship, and they're telling captain, this is what we want you to do. The other story I mentioned was one where the captain is telling his crew, this is what I want you to do. And it's just nuts to have data like that to confirm everything right. else that you read.
That second letter, that was Edward Duvall.
Duvall, right.
Richard.
Right. There's a book about him too.
Richard Cougar was the director of this museum when the library here was opened.
I met him. He died recently.
That's right. And to celebrate the opening of the library, the Whaling Museum published William Duvall's, the captain's specific orders.
Right.
But from one thing, I should tell the audience that this letter that we're talking about from Christopher Mitchell and Company to Samuel Harris. There are hundreds and hundreds of these letters in whaling libraries, but nobody's ever put one in a book verbatim. So if for absolutely no other reason, you know, that letter in its full text is a really fabulous primary source, you know, that Skip has included in his work. There's one more question, and I think we're going to wrap it up, Skip. Lynn. Oh, Lynn has a whaling log.
Whoa!
Skip's out of New Bedford, and she'll bring him to the Whaling Museum at some point.
Oh, my goodness!
Yes. An energetic presentation. So Lynn thinks that you're both fabulous and energetic.
That's nice.
Thanks, Lynn. Hey, thanks, everybody. Thanks, Skip.
Michael, thank you. Dude, I'm such a fan. I can't wait to meet you in person. I'm looking forward to two hugs.
Yeah, well, we'll get together one of these days, and it'll be a good day. So
I miss it over there.
Congratulations
yeah.
on your book, and I hope your presentation at Mystic goes really well. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Again. I appreciate it. Thank you, guys.